Well, I had heard about Cortez Bank as a fishing grounds. My grandfather was a big time fisherman in Southern California, and he loved tuna. He loved going out for fish out at exotic places, and one of those places was the Cortez Bank. Now, did I know, is it a surf spot? No.
Cortez Bank sits about 100 miles nearly due west of San Diego, so it's really out in the middle of the ocean. The interesting thing about Cortez is it's one of the Channel Islands, basically. It's a seamount. You know, like you go back 10,000 years when sea levels were different, it was actually above water, so it was like an island. And then, you know, sea levels have come back up, it's become this, you know, vast kind of underwater reef system where there's great fishing and there's, you know, scary surfing.
So the whole Project Neptune concept was, it was really a project hatched by Flame and Sean Collins, right? So I was fortunate enough to be working with both of those guys at Surfline and Swell, and so I was in the inner circle.
I got brought into the secret meetings of the Cortez Bank through Larry Moore. And that was the first time I went into the surfing magazine offices. Larry was there, and he showed me the first photos that he had had.
Sean and Flame started talking about it in like the mid-80s, I think, something like that, or maybe it was the early 90s. I mean, it was on the radar for a while, I think. You know, it might have taken Sean several months, a year, I don't know, to kind of figure everything out, because Flame was feeding him kind of all this information on some of his older trips out there, what he was seeing exactly. And then Sean kind of hindcasted a bunch of those swells and started looking at all the bathymetry charts and the bottom and just started to piece it together and figure it out.
At that time, we had just started the Quicksilver Men Who Ride Mountains event. And that swell was something that was, you know, very much forecasted to be big at Mavericks. At that point, it was forecasted to be south winds, which generally means that the storm comes too close to the coast and it ruins the wave and you're not able to surf it, right? But this place, which sits another, you know, 350 miles south and another 100 miles off the coast, it was forecast to be just pristine.
So that's kind of the cool thing about this mission, is it's not that it's so rare for Cortez to have swell like that. Like, it happens. Like, it'll happen a few times every winter where it'll be big. It's lining up with those good conditions out there. You don't want to be rolling 100 miles out to sea with 25 knot northwest wind in your face. You know, number one, it's a hell of a boat trip. And then number two, the surf's no good when you get out there, just blown out.
So I'm in the middle of this thing going, well, I was in the Mavericks contest, you know, with Quicksilver as an athlete and a liaison for the event. And we're discussing that whole thing. And then I had this phone call that said, hey, Cortez Bank's gonna be doing this thing too. And so I was kind of torn, like, you know, and I couldn't really sway one way or the other. I just kind of had to sit and wait it out. And ultimately the decision was made at that point that, you know, Mavericks was gonna be windy and so they weren't gonna run the event. And sure enough, we packed our boards up, went straight to Cortez Bank that night. Drove to San Diego and jumped on a boat and made the mission. We roll into San Diego, into the parking lot. It's the first time I've ever been to that harbor. So we got there in the afternoon, and we're supposed to meet the captain, right? And I remember we were kind of skating around the parking lot, and all of a sudden this guy walks up and he's, you know, way younger than me, way younger than our group. And he goes, hey man, I'm John, you know, I'm your captain. I'm like, you know, kind of look at him like, you're a captain? Like, we're going to the moon, you know, like and our captain's younger than we are. Like, it was kind of a unique experience because I really didn't know how much experience he's had, you know, and sure enough, the deckhand's one of his buddies who's super young too. So we got this really young crew that's gonna take us out there to the moon. You know, in our eyes, that's what it was.
The bank itself's 20 miles long.
No,
the
but
area
that
we're working is probably, I'd say, like 3/4 of a mile.
As we were going out, I remember that we were a little bit disappointed in the buoy readings further up north. And to be honest, that wasn't that big of a, I mean, it was a big swell, but it wasn't like, oh my gosh, that's the biggest swell we've had in, you know, 20 years or anything.
I think the deep water swell height was kind of right around 15 to 17 feet at 20 seconds, which substantial swell for sure. We've certainly seen other swells that are as big or a few feet bigger. What made that event so special was just the local wind conditions out there and the fact that those local wind conditions coincided with that swell.
We ended up leaving the harbor at midnight or something. It was tough to get any kind of shut eye. I mean, you're so anxious and nervous and excited, you know, to get out there and you know, swaying the whole way out, and the whole time you're just freaking out what you're gonna see.
It was early in the morning, and we were just trying to figure out where to anchor and where to be, just to be safe, knowing that there's a lot of swell in the water. And I just do remember you could literally see, I don't know, like readings or something on the radar of something, and it turned out there was nothing out there. It was waves.
Large.
Those are waves right there. That's a boat. We just need the sun to come up.
Yeah, there's peaks out there.
Dude, it just breaks everywhere.
In there.
On this radar, you're seeing a blip going around, and every time you go over the bank, it would be this, you know, this little picture of a wave, or, you know, of this reef. And that part, you're like, whoa, you know, the ghost is real, and you know, and how big is it? You know, like, can we ride it? You know, no one really knew.
There were some big ones.
Sure.
Obviously.
What? Look at that.
You know, we got there. It was about as perfect an ocean as you could possibly have for surfing big waves. It wasn't it was very, very light offshore breeze, you know, so it was just this, you know, you'd see these things marching in, and it looked like an 8-foot wave. We're like, really don't know how big it is, and we're still, you know, a mile away from it, kind of creeping up on it. The feeling was, is just, you know, same thing, I was had the anticipation, and all of a sudden it was this adrenaline pump of excitement and wanting to get out there super quickly, because you didn't know how long this was gonna last, this perfect conditions, and just this excitement and feeling of adrenaline just pumping through your body that you don't get anywhere else.
Here we are, Cortez Banks. Took us all night and a couple stalls, but we're here.
Because it's so far out in the middle of the ocean, there's no continental shelf that would start to slow waves up at all or anything like that. So it's just pure open ocean swell. What that means is if you talk to any of the guys that have surfed out there, is they'll tell you it's moving faster than anything they've ever surfed before.
To describe my first ride, I remember, you know, literally feeling the speed of the wave. I had this John Carper tow board that was the most amazing board that I still, to this day, it's one of the best boards I've ever had. You know, and I'd ridden a lot of waves on it, and again, it just felt, you know, had more speed, more drive, all of these things. And I just remember kicking out and just, you know, this wave that was, I'd never gone that fast on a surfboard before in my life.
As waves or a swell starts to move into shallow water, it starts to slow up a little bit. You know, you're 100 miles out to sea at Cortez Bank. It's just deep, open ocean all around. So you're looking at really long period swell. It's like 18 to 20 seconds long. That means it's moving around 30 knots per hour. So it's booking out there.
Evan Slater came out on this trip. He's an accomplished big wave rider. You know, he was kind of going out to kind of document and also experience this wave. And him and John Walla, you know, we were riding wave after wave after wave, and they're like, well, it's so perfect. They've been watching for so many hours. They decided to just paddle out.
I didn't know how to tow and surf. I just knew that I loved big waves and I wanted to be a part of the thing. It was more of like a stowaway with my 9.8 and try to get a couple waves on the shoulder. There were two different peaks. There was the wide one that would hit, and then there was the deeper one that the guys were towing into. So we wanted to sit, it's kind of the equivalent of like the West Bowl at sunset and the North Peak. Very similar.
And I do recall, like, the scariest moment is that I'm riding a wave, big set wave, and I'm actually looking at these guys, and I'm doing a bottom turn, you know, and I'm looking at John, and John, and then right behind him was Evan. John was able to somehow get through. Like, he was actually just enough far enough outside that he was able to punch through the wave. He like bailed his board but got out the back, whereas Evan took the thing directly on his head. I remember like instantly kicking out and, you know, screaming to get the guys, you know, like waving, get him, because they had just gotten cleaned up by, it must have been a 25, 30 foot, you know, swell that translates into 60 foot faces. And that's the worst case scenario for any big wave rider.
That was when we just sort of like, you know, cut our losses and had enough, I guess, humility and smarts to like know that maybe we're out of our league a little bit.
You know, this history really being, obviously, it was the first time they'd ever surf huge waves out there. It wasn't the first time surf, but it was the first time that it had been done in the way that we had done it. fully documented with great surfers and a great crew, and then also to see the wave that Mike Parsons rode, the historic wave that he rode out there. It's still one of the most biggest and beautiful waves ever ridden.
More than anything, like being just there and seeing what those guys did on that day was certainly a milestone in surfing and opened up all the big wave expansion you've seen around the world. It really was, because it got people thinking like, hey, if you can do that 100 miles off the coast of California, what about Ireland? What about Spain? All these other places, and it really, created a whole global big wave community.
I've always said that the best part of big wave riding is that moment after the sessions when you're able to sit with the people you just shared it with and reflect. And the main reason for me why I'd like to ride big waves is to be able to sit back and just feel so in the now and euphoric and genuine and real, like you just have done something that, like you fulfilled a life purpose. You only probably do it maybe, if you're lucky, 3 or 4 times in your life, right?
I'll never forget this, is we had no idea how it looked. I mean, we knew it was big, but we had no idea like how big it was kind of, and how it really looked from, the kind of perspective that Flame had. When I get to the dock, however many hours after the boat ride, I remember my cell phone works, that little flip phone, and first message was from Flame, and it was like from the plane, and so you could hear the propellers in the background and stuff, and he's like, "We did it, buddy! We did it!" And just thinking about it now gives me goosebumps, because I'd never heard him. So it was like almost like all the stuff that he had worked toward in his life had like culminated in that moment, in that day, because that's what he stood for. It's like groundbreaking, big waves, just shocking people, and then putting his favorite surfers in the waves of their lives. And Flame was he was responsible. Him and Sean were just critical to making, obviously, to making the whole thing happen.